Let's keep going. So yeah. Okay. So back to log lines. I don't even know where we were at. We were talking about log lines. This has been quite an adventure. So anyway, log lines. Maybe you could give us an example of what you would consider to be a good log line. Like if you have one that you can think of, or even if you want to look on your computer real quick, and find a log line that you really think worked. I know Chris is an expert at it, so we'll let Chris go first because he,
Oh, come on. I
you
gotta pull him up.
you are an expert
I
at log.
had we had we had we
That's
had
true.
all of this time, all of this downtime when I could have been pulling them up,
That is true.
and now you throw me on the spot.
That's true.
Give me a minute and I'll pull up a few.
Okay. Aaron, what's the best what's a log line for one of your things or things that you've worked on maybe or something? Is there
Well, I mean,
anything?
I can give you like a quick instant log line for the show that I work on, Sydney to the
Yeah,
Max.
no, that'd be great. Perfect.
Just a disclaimer, this is for a television show as opposed to a film, so it's
Sure.
just a quick wrap up of what the show is. It follows a middle schooler named Sydney Reynolds as she navigates middle school life with the help of her dad and grandma, and as she encounters each new challenge. The show flashes back to the 90s when her father was a little boy, living with her grandma who plays his mother in the 90s. And so it's a fun show that exists in two time periods with two kids that age growing up and navigating life that way. So I think what I was saying before applies here, which is thinking about your log line as a way to share your thoughts and feelings about your story with your audience. I think a couple of the discussions we were having before alluded to the idea that your log line is something that's malleable and can change. And so I think it really comes down to being able to talk about your project in a succinct and exciting way. And I think that's ultimately what a log line is. And to me at least. And I think it changes because your perception and your progress on your own story is constantly changing as well. So the way that you may describe it, the way that you may write it. I know that in television production, with every show that I work on, we are constantly changing different versions of an episode or a season because we're figuring it out as we go. And we have an idea at the beginning of what a season or an episode looks like, a pilot looks like, and then as we write, the log line evolves and adapts.
So Christopher Lockhart, you look like you've got your list up. Can you
I got
throw
something. I
us a
found
log
something.
line?
All right, so this is the actual log line that I sent to John David Washington, who starred in The Black Klansman, for The Black Klansman. Colorado Springs' first black policeman infiltrates the local chapter of the KKK, posing as a white man with the intent of taking down the organization.
Okay. No, that's good. It's clear, it's concise, it lets you know exactly what's going on. It's compelling.
And then he can ask questions.
Now, is that a log line you wrote, or is that a log line that the writer actually wrote for his?
No, this is one that I
Oh,
wrote.
great.
I never use anybody else's log lines.
Okay.
I just because I have to send it to my client, and so I really want it to be for me because then I'll often have to engage in a conversation, and so I just want it all to sort of come from me.
So all of this work that I'm doing when I write a log line is just in hopes of getting to the point where you throw away my log line and find a
Probably
new one.
because ultimately, maybe I just have a really big ego. And by the way, we're talking about writing log lines. I'm not splitting an atom. So, I always feel like I can do a much better job on a log line. Because often I feel like writers tend to put in more information than is really necessary for the log line. Like my clients, they can get distracted very easily. Plus, they have all kinds of projects are being waved at them. I worked with Denzel Washington, working with him for 25 years. He gets thousands of offers a year. to be in all kinds of projects. And so, you know, their attention span is very short when it comes to this stuff. So, you know, I feel like I know best how to communicate a story to them in a way that is going to be receptive.
Mm-hmm. So, Chris, you actually said something really interesting there. I just wanted to kind of highlight because I was listening to the log line. I found it incredibly appealing from the perspective of somebody who may be playing that character, right? And we were talking about ways that you may be, you know, using a log line. This is a way maybe where you're trying to attach talent or you're trying to get talent interested. The other thing I'll say, just because kind of as a quick takeaway from what I loved about that log line, is it tells me who the character is, what they want, how they're going to do it, and maybe why they're doing it. All in one sentence, which is, I mean, if you think about it, it's an incredibly powerful statement, quick statement, because it really gives you, you know, most, if not all, of the information you need to know what the story is ultimately going to be.
Yeah, and you know, look, like there are a lot of amazing things in the screenplay that are not included here. Like, for example, his relationship with his coworker, the Adam Driver character, right? And but that information wouldn't be essential for the logline, in my opinion. And so yeah, I'm just always trying to find the most streamlined way to present the dramatic core of the story so somebody can see it and say, you know something? I can see a movie there. Mm-hmm. And then they want to know more. Can I read my log line for Jaws? No, yeah. I did not send a log line to Roy Scheider because I was a child when Jaws came out. But so here's a log line for Jaws. A hydrophobic sheriff struggles to kill a man-eating shark during tourist season when the Chamber of Commerce refuses to close the beach.
Mm-hmm.
You know, look, there's probably 1,000 different ways that you can write a log line for Jaws. I'm not saying mine is the only way, or I'm not saying that it's the best way, but to me, it's streamlined.
And Kevin, you know, that log line actually illustrates a point that I made before that I want to come back to, which is that was a hydrophobic sheriff, right? And Jaws, right? So mm-hmm. You look at these two elements that are opposed to each other, right? You look at a character who is serving a purpose in the story. You have this incredible world, this incredible shark that's going to obviously become this iconic figure in history. What is a character that best serves that story? A hydrophobic sheriff.
Right.
When I'm looking at building the pieces of a compelling story, those are ideas that come to mind. And certainly there are ideas that make their way into a streamlined summary of what my project is going to become.
And I think that is such a great point, which is that sometimes writers don't have the best character in their story. And so just playing around with a log line in the beginning might really enable you to sort of come up with that character, tweak that character somehow, some way, so the character conflicts with the story more.
Mm-hmm.
But clearly, if the sheriff were, you know, an Olympic surfer, for example, you know, a gold medalist swimmer turned sheriff, I don't know, maybe that doesn't create as much conflict as a sheriff who's afraid of water.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see the gold medal swimmer get eaten.
Well, that would be nice. Yes, yes.
That's a great.
I don't want to see him beat the shark. I want to see him get eaten.
Wasn't that a commercial where Michael Phelps raced a shark or something like that, but it was a digital shark for Shark Week? I think that was like an ad campaign / gimmick that they ran on Shark Week. Like, Michael Phelps races a shark or something like that, but it was digital and all that kind of thing. But anyway,
I would watch that. Can I do one more?
Yeah, please.
All right, and again, let me find it. How about I do a bad log line and then do a better log line?
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to do a bad log line and then a better log line. So here's a bad log line, in my opinion, for The Sixth Sense. When a young boy claims to see dead people, a distraught psychologist struggles to help him. When a young boy claims to see dead people, a distraught psychologist struggles to help him. Now that, you know, that to me is a pretty, that's a pretty accurate log line for the sixth sense.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe it could be written in a slightly better way. How about this? A distraught psychologist struggles to help a young boy overcome a bizarre affliction. The boy sees dead people.
Hmm. Yeah. Especially because you leave the surprise at the end.
You leave the best for last. Yeah. Right. So you kind of build to it a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I'm not saying it is the best version of the logline. You know, throwing in an adjective to describe the character, right? So it's a, he's a distraught psychologist, mm-hmm. rather than just a psychologist, or rather than the character's name, which for me never helps. Never helps to say, Joe struggles to help a young boy, because I don't know who Joe is, right? So names don't help, proper names don't help.
Right.
Trying to find a way to describe the character, you know, with a noun and adjective, to me is much more effective.
Now, mm-hmm. the exception to that would be, of course, if you were writing about like Henry VIII or Napoleon.
Or Aaron Brockovich.
Yes, however, my caveat would still be that you might still need an adjective because Abraham Lincoln in the John Ford movie, Abe Lincoln in Illinois, is a very different Abe Lincoln than the Steven Spielberg movie Lincoln. They're two incredibly different Abraham Lincolns. And so to just say Abraham Lincoln maybe is not enough, but to describe with an adjective might help to really sort of orient us as to who Abraham Lincoln is in this story. We know he's the president, but in Abe Lincoln, Illinois, he's this young politician. And in Lincoln, he's really sort of at the end of his life, struggling to pass a constitutional amendment. So, very, very different depictions.
You also use the adjective distraught in describing Bruce Willis's character, and without spoiling the movie for anyone, that is something that plays quite a role in the way that the story unfolds. And so I think that is actually a critical element of the logline as it is, and, mm-hmm. and a unique selling tool for that particular project.
And you could, of course, you know, there could be 80,000 other potential adjectives. This is not necessarily the best one. So it's always about tinkering. Like at work, I'll often sort of slave over a logline a little bit, especially if the script is a little bit problematic. And so like, I don't like to spend more than 15 or 20 minutes on a logline because I have a lot of other things that I have to be doing. But I will always play around with the adjectives and the nouns and really like, what's the best way to describe the Bruce Willis character? What's the best way to describe the Sheriff Brody character in Jaws? And often I will think, my God, I've come up with the greatest, just the absolute greatest solution. And then a coworker will read it and go, you know, how about you say blah, blah, blah. I'm like, oh God, that's even better.
Yeah. And I think also this illustrates the point of if you're having trouble with your log line, maybe you are having trouble in your script.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I read a lot of scripts as just part of my work and, you know, outside of work, and I really want to know who your main character is, what they want, you know, right in the first couple pages. And so, you know, if you're struggling with your log line and you don't know those things in your log line, and you've already written a script or part of a script or an act, those are things that I think need to be addressed in the script first. You know, tell me in the first couple pages who your character is. You know, show me through action what they want, where they're coming from, who they are, describe them for me, and then show me active steps to them trying to get what they want right away.
Mm-hmm.
Get the story going. Otherwise, you're not going to grab me as a reader the same way you're not going to grab me with your log line.
Jelena, do you have a log line you want to throw at us?
Sure, yeah. And I am by no means the type of expert that any of the other folks on the panel are, so feel free to pick these apart. I will not be offended. I have a much easier time doing other people's log lines than my own.
As do we all, by the way. As do we all.
Because you're not precious about anything in someone else's. You mm-hmm. can yank out their favorite part of it, and you don't know that that was their favorite part of it. You can just see that it didn't deserve to be there. So I think Chris has actually seen this particular logline before and moved it forward in the Script Subscribes logline contest. So I'll start with the one that I know that Chris at least liked somewhat. So this is my general kind of calling card script that gets me most of my meetings. And the logline is, a foul-mouthed forensic sculptor trying to kick her fentanyl habit discovers her creations can speak to her and help her solve their murders, but only when she's using.
Hmm. Was this a TV show?
Everything with me is pilots. I can give you a very much in development one. I am writing a feature, so we can play with my one that I haven't even written the script yet if we want to. But
I remember that from Kevin's contest. I do.
You know, logline madness.
Yes,
it was madness.
It was madness. Okay, good. So I thought that it's a good logline, and it reminded me a little of the logline Chris had for Sixth Sense, in that you had that surprise at the end, which I think is important. I think that really kind of grabs the reader.
Yeah, you really have to think about how you structure the logline also. So,
yeah.
Because you really are trying to structure it for maximum impact, right? So, yes, you're trying to get out all of this information in the most streamlined way possible, but you also want to create, you know, a little bit of sizzle in it, if possible.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of like a scene, right? Like, I was just having this conversation on Twitter last night, remembering a piece of writing advice that I got from Matt Whitten, who wrote on House and a bunch of other shows and now teaches at UCLA, which is your character should, as much as possible, never enter a scene expecting something and leave the scene having gotten the thing that they expected. And it's kind of the same for log lines, is that the reader should never enter the log line expecting something from the first couple of words and then leave the log line having gotten exactly what they expected from the first couple of words.
Right.
I think that's a really interesting point. And because it doesn't mean that the logline will be bad if you get everything that you expect, but it will mean that it is pedestrian, right? So I'll say, oh yeah, like the logline works, but I've seen this before. Where's the hook, right? Because look, ultimately, like even with The Sixth Sense, like let's really stop and think about The Sixth Sense, which I think is a brilliant movie, right? But it's just a ghost story, right? It's like, but the kid doesn't see ghosts. He sees dead people, right? But they're ghosts, right? It's just, you know, M. Night just kind of rebrands it. And so it's sad.
And it's not a sixth sense at all. That's the thing that drives me nuts about The Sixth Sense, is he's using one of the five senses to see these ghosts. Right. There's no sixth sense. His eyes just are seeing other things. That's
an interesting point. However, though, one could argue that being able to see spirits is a sixth sense, right?
Also,
it's like an extrasensory perception.
Also, I think you can look at that movie as a log line, right? You look, if you know, again, not to spoil it, but the moment at the end of the movie is the end of the log line, right? Or the way that you could tell a log line if you wanted to give away the end of the movie, just the way, you know, I write a lot of jokes, you want to end the joke on the right word. You want to end the joke on the right phrase. It's the same thing. You want to end on an up moment for whoever is hearing or reading your material. And I think the brilliance to me of that film is the way the story is told. Ending with that incredible moment at the end is to me what made that movie so unique. Because you're right, Chris. It's just another ghost story. It's just the way that it's told is to me what makes it unique. Yeah.
It's very emotional. It's really, for me, just anytime I read a script, I want an emotional experience. For me, reading screenplays and making movies is not an intellectual experience. It is first and foremost an emotional experience. And that to me is what's so effective about The Sixth Sense, is that it really, every time I see that scene with him and his mother in the car, and he starts to tell her how grandma was there the day that, you know, she did, I'm like crying like a baby, you know? And this is supposed to be a ghost story. Like, you know, why am I crying? So, and by the way, I saw that ending a million miles away. When I saw the movie, and it didn't matter. It didn't matter because the journey was so compelling. That story would work even without that twist ending, which is why the twist ending is so effective and why the movie is so good. And then of course you'll note that we don't include the ending, that twist, in the logline. Right? Because often a lot of people say, oh gee, I want to include my twist in the logline. And yeah, you want to include the twist in the logline because your logline sucks, and you believe that by including the twist, it's going to add extra life to it. But look, the logline for The Sixth Sense is pretty compelling without us knowing that twist in the end.
Right. And I was the one with the friend who told me what the ending was before I got to see it. So anyway.
Well, I mean, it really doesn't matter if the movie's good enough, right?
No,
like
sure.
Hamilton, the very first song, Aaron Burr tells you he shot Hamilton, if you didn't know historically that Aaron Burr shot Hamilton. And so you know you're watching a movie that's going to end with Aaron Burr shooting Alexander Hamilton. But
We know that William Holden is going to drown in a swimming pool in Sunset Boulevard. We know that Kevin Spacey is going to die at the end of American Beauty. Yeah, I agree. It's, but that's always the key. And so when I talk to writers and they're so excited about the end and the twist, and that they want to build their whole pitch around a twist, it's such a red flag for me. It's such a red flag because I know that, man, everything else probably isn't as good. And then the reality is that nobody may ever get to that twist because they might, as Aaron said earlier, tune out of the script by page 10.
Right. Which I'm sure happens.
And I think, you know, an effective screenplay is going to have characters that you care about, that you want to follow, that you attach yourself to early on in the story. You want someone to root for, you want someone maybe even to root against, you want someone to follow and be interested and see what happens to them on their journey in trying to get what they want. And I think that a great log line will include that as well.
Right. Absolutely. So I wanted to open it up to some folks in the chat to see if anyone has log lines that they would love to have, get a little bit of feedback on. Spiral Gold in the chat did say that Sixth Sense is, or that Sixth Sense, the movie, or seeing ghosts, is definitely a Sixth Sense. So anyway,
I don't buy it. It's like super tasters who have an extra taste. You're just a super seer.
A super taster. I get it. Let's see here. We do have a couple on Twitter that they were left for us. The first from David Wales is a logline for a feature thriller called Blue Girl. In 1580s Switzerland, a sweet girl transforms into a figure of dread to survive the bloodlust of the villagers, who credit to witchcraft the genetic disease that is inexorably turning her blue. I'll read it one more time. It's called Blue Girl.